Hello, everyone. My name is Taylor Bug, and I'm the marketing coordinator here at Cloud for Good. And I'm happy to welcome you to today's webinar, Harnessing the Power of Your Data. We have a ton of really great content planned for you today, and we will have time for Q&A at the end. So please be sure to submit all of your questions using that Q&A widget on your screen. For those of you who don't know Cloud for Good yet, first off, welcome. We're so happy that you've decided to join us today. We are a Salesforce premium partner who helps those in the nonprofit and education spaces create more value. We do this by bringing over 10 years of experience working with every cloud and every use case to our implementations. Cloud for Good is also a design partner for the Education Cloud. So prior to its launch, we actually provided guidance and feedback on the tools and now have a continuous loop of feedback and communication with the Salesforce team as we implement Education Cloud for our customers. We also take our learnings from each implementation and create accelerators across all clouds and education use cases. These accelerators provide our clients with an initial starting point for key configuration and increased time to value by allowing us to streamline our implementation timelines. And I'd love to introduce today's lovely subject matter experts, Brian Davis, Brian Forrest, Samuel, and Tom. Before we jump into things, I'd love to pass it over to you all to share a little bit more about yourselves. So Brian Davis, do you want to kick us off?
Sure. Thanks, Taylor. So my name is Brian Davis. I am with LSU Online Continuing Education about 3 years now. My previous background has been in private sector. I've been designing software systems and leading software teams for about 20 plus years now. So, yep, glad to be here.
Thanks, Brian. Do you want to go Brian Forrest next?
Absolutely. I am Brian Forrest, spelled with a Y, not with an I. I'm coming at you live from the Chicago Tower today, and I am the North American Vice President for Education here. So I deal with mid-market schools, community colleges, large enterprise schools, and also our for-profit business. Excited to be here today. Thanks, Taylor.
Thanks, Brian. Samuel, do you want to go next?
Okay, thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Samuel. I'm from Cloud for Good. I'm the senior data warehouse developer. My focus is on data migration, data warehousing, design, implementation, end-to-end. I'd love to be here today.
Thanks, Samuel. And Tom, do you want to round us out?
Yes, so I'm Tom Bueno. I am also with LSU Online and Continuing Education. I've got about 20 plus years of experience managing Salesforce implementations, primarily in high tech and financial, kind of newer to the higher ed part, but I'm really enjoying it and looking to bring some of that high tech thought process over to higher ed.
Awesome. Thank you all again for being here today. I think we have Brian Forrest up next to talk a little bit more about today's education landscape.
Yeah, so Taylor, I love talking about data, specifically because I think education is sitting on piles of data that corporate America would kill to have. They would love to know everything about your students, your constituents, or even your customers, if we dare call them that, and leverage that in order to complete that 360 experience. One of the things I would challenge you with today that I hear about when I travel across the country is everybody wants AI. Everybody wants to know how they can leverage the power of AI. I challenge you to think, where does your data sit and what is your data strategy? Think about your favorite corporate America examples. Maybe it's Marriott, maybe it's Southwest, maybe it's Home Depot, maybe it's the Adidas app that you use to order your kids' shoes. How are they using your information to better serve you as a customer? That's what data is all about. And the cool thing about higher ed is you all have a ton of data that you can leverage, not only to further educate people, to make sure they don't fall out of the system, and also to maybe work with them after they graduate from your institution to get them more certificates or things of that nature. So particularly excited to hear this crew talk about how they're leveraging their data today. Taylor, I think we're gonna hand it over to Brian D from here, correct?
Yep, that's right. So Brian, I'm glad you mentioned about, you know, AI. That's definitely the hot topic over the past year and a half or so. And, you know, one thing that I hope people understand is that in order to leverage technologies around, you know, like AI, data is extremely important. I mean, it'll be as good as the data that you're able to get it. And with your universities, I mean, not just universities, but all over, no matter what sector you're in, there is a need for your systems to be able to communicate with each other, and that's done by sharing data. So it doesn't matter if it's your CRM with Salesforce or any applications that you have that are interfacing with your students or professors or what have you, or it could be systems that you have internally where you need to make, you need some type of notifications to make decisions or anything like that, or your system-wide, your enterprise software systems that, let's say your main IT guys and gals are using, there's usually a need to share that information across those systems. So another way of saying those systems need to talk to each other, and those are done different ways, and those challenges are not necessarily unique to higher ed, but they are commonplace for any group that has more than one software system. All right. And at LSU OCE, we have been using Salesforce for quite a while now. So for the past 5 to 6 years, we've been on a very interesting and fun, rewarding Salesforce journey. And we've seen tons of benefits throughout the years. Primarily, we are using our CRM where we're putting in automations in place and leveraging it in a way where we can help our staff do what they do best. And our staff is very high touch. We're very personable with our learners. And we want to make sure that the systems that we have in place, especially our CRM, allows them to focus on the learner and not to be so bogged down into the day-to-day things that need to be done. There's always tasks and what have you that have to be done. Those are the things that they're not particularly interested in, to be honest, right? They're more concerned about being there for our learners and being able to implement Salesforce in a way that allows them to be in tune with those learners. I mean, we've had success across the board, and we've had record numbers in just about every category that you can imagine. We've had a tremendous experience so far with leveraging Salesforce.
And one of the things that kind of drove us to, you know, take this holistic approach at LSU OCE was, you know, a problem not uncommon to a lot of organizations, whether it's higher ed or any Salesforce users. You kind of bring the system in, you implement it, you customize it, you kind of use it a little bit for everything. And at OCE, one of our biggest challenges, we have a highly customized implementation on EDA that also is kind of serving as a data warehouse, right? So we've built features and functions in Salesforce CRM to drive other related business processes such as marketing. And that's not always the most intuitive or clean thing to do with your CRM. The other thing that it does is it prevents us from being able to leverage any of the new features and functionality kind of out of the box because we have an over-customized environment. So One of the key principles in moving over to Education Cloud that we wanted to keep kind of upfront and foremost is not using the CRM as a data warehouse, right? We want to be able to create a holistic architecture that allows us to harmonize learner data using Education Cloud or using Data Cloud. And then the other thing on the Data Cloud piece is really enabling the self-service on data for some of our key business stakeholders. You know, Brian kind of talked about the quality of data that is required to enable AI. Well, AI is something that we really want to take advantage of in Data Cloud so that we can enable all of our key stakeholders within the business to be more self-sufficient, use things like natural language querying to support their business needs and be less reliant upon IT to do some of these day-to-day tasks.
Whoops. So thank you. So we have seen how data can be utilized as a different levels to make an impact. Now we're going to switch gear a little bit. and focus on the nature of data itself. We saw the power of consolidating learner identities into a single profile, right? But what about identities or networks of identities go beyond the education domain? What could have missed if we do not connect the dots, so to speak? Now, meet Sheila. She has some extraordinary accomplishments, a STEM fellowship alumni, current donor to the robotics programs, speaker at the Women in Technology Seminar, chief of staff in a large technology firm. Now, being a former student who donates programs she was involved in, she's a huge advocate for the organization. And the potential to unlock her network would be, and also the connected communities of leaders would be very significant. Now, there's just a very slight problem with this picture, right? How do we know that the four roles and four different roles and responsibilities that we just described are the same physical person? Well, because I just told you, we just showed them, right? However, in the data world, as you see in this screen, for business without a data strategy, each of these are just silo systems, right? They're great systems on its own, but without a way to connect them, they're just systems that host one digital version of Sheila. Some systems may not even know her information, even though she could be a huge support for them. And then there's also the potential loss of all the net relationships and networks that Sheila knows about, right? So business users will not be able to assemble a holistic view of the same person in reality. So what we need to do is to take a strategic and centralized approach to integrating existing data and systems wherever possible. And the lost potential here is not just the long-term relationship, but also awareness of further engagement changes, not just limited to Sheila. Next slide, please. Thank you, Taylor. But other relationship as well, as you see in here. Because built on top of that, by connecting different data sources, we're not just for the current events, but also paving the way for the future, where there's AI and automation identifying patterns and triggers for further engagements. And as we continue to building this data landscape, right, and expanding our understandings of Sheila's network outside of the institution, we began to truly see the interconnected community of leaders of driving impact across not just the local assistance, but across geographies, generations, and viewpoints. Having said all that, it all comes back down to data. So that's why we definitely need a strategy so that we can build trust in our data and our process to produce value. So let's talk about data strategy. Next slide, please. So we break it down into five different steps as the first step within define your data strategy. Okay. Next slide, please. The first step would be to understand your institution goal and objective. What are we trying to solve here, right? What are some of the data objectives where it can, all the success can be influenced by data? And every institution and department would have their own vision and goals that we're looking for, right? So to give you some ideas, I'm gonna pass it to Brian Davis to talk about setting goals and objectives in LSU. Brian?
Yeah, thanks, Samuel. So coming in, like I said, I've been at LSU now for about 3 years. My background's in software design. A lot of what we've implemented over the past 3 years has honestly been around best practice around software, around architecture, around system design. One of the challenges that we've had, like we mentioned before, is there are so many different systems that we have in our ecosystem, right? I mean, I'm sure you all have the same things, right? Your LMS needs to know what your CRM knows, the CRM needs to know what the registration system knows, et cetera. In order to get information out of those systems, we need to be able to do so in an easy fashion so that our business can make decisions. And unfortunately, because those systems were so separate, it wasn't easy to get all that information together. So for step one, we're talking about best practices. how can we get that information together, right? Can we stand up some sort of warehouse to make it easy for our business to make decisions on that holistic information from our from our student standpoint? And then once we get that information together, it's how can we provide a way, as Tom mentioned before, to enable our business to be able to get that information on our own. What we didn't want to do is we didn't want to hamstring our departments where they're moving at a super fast pace and they're innovating and they're getting going, but they're dependent on IT to get that information for them. And IT is busy on a lot of the initiatives that they have, right? So we're constantly innovating ourselves and building out systems. And so they needed a way to be able to get that information on our own. So what we were looking to get, just in summary, just a way to tell the story of our students, so get that information all in one spot, and then easily enable the business to be able to get that information on their own so they can move at their own pace.
Thank you, Brian. That actually is perfect because it aligns perfectly with the following steps that we have right away, is to actually evaluate the current landscape. As mentioned by Brian, right, there are a lot of systems out there. So one of this step is actually almost like doing inventory count of the systems that you have data in. We mentioned about LMS, SIS, CRM. I'm sure we have spreadsheets, we have finance, alumni, we have more spreadsheets, legacy systems, and then more spreadsheets, right? So we have to really know where our data is. And then following that is a step to able to calculate or determine the complexity of bringing data in later on, because each system will have their own way of storing the data on different formats, right? So having automating a process comparing to a local spreadsheet or bringing data in or even paper would be very different. Now, even knowing where the data is stored, how confident are we in the data, right? If I ask you right now, do you trust in your data, right? All these data quality and data gaps and the understanding of how data flows among them, where does the data actually end? That's an actually very common scenario. One of the hardest item to track with legacy system is to really understand what's in there and how they are moving among them. And that's part of the evaluation of the data landscape. Now, the third step, which is my favorite part, is the data architecture and integration plan. This is the fun part. Think of it as putting the blueprint together, right? Imagine you're opening a store, right? You have the front end, you have the back end. Now you have to think about how to bring stuff in, how to put the products where to put them, and you have to move it between front and back. Now also you have to decide who have access to what and when to bring these out to, right? So a lot of these actually brings over to the digital data world too. But good news though, we are, because of digital, we're able to present you with a diagram to describe all these actions within a picture. So again, I will pass it to Tom to use LSU as an example in their implementation. Tom?
Yep. So next slide. All right, so this is, you know, just a high level diagram of the architecture that we're implementing at LSU OCE. And so, I mean, if I step back, I don't have a diagram here for it, but, you know, all of the data sources on the left, you know, currently flow into our Salesforce EDA, right? And then data flows out for the different of EDA for, you know, different Tableau, SaaS, Marketing Cloud, all of these different tools. And like we said, that presents challenges in the way that we're really using the Salesforce environment for something that's not intended to. And so if you look at the diagram here, what we've done is using a combination of a data lake and data cloud as a warehouse, we've created a big data strategy in that all of the data that we have flows back into data lake. Then we, and that's really just kind of raw sets of data. And then we come back out and we take all of that data and we take all that data and we filter it, structure it, and we put it in data cloud. Data cloud then becomes the source of truth. So anything that we need, we get from data cloud, and so data cloud now becomes the source for Tableau, for reporting, And again, even for education cloud. So if there's bits of data that we need out of education cloud, we take that back out. We put it back into our big data environment, and then ultimately it ends up back in data cloud as our source of truth, right? And that's the key that we're trying to get to here with this, is we have all of these different pieces of the architecture and ecosystem that are really fit for purpose, right? So we're just using them all for their individual needs. And then we are taking and putting that all into data cloud to serve as a source of truth.
Thank you so much, Tom. That was great. Thank you. So as you can see, a data architecture diagram like this one will be tell you a lot of very important information, right? As part of the architecture exercise, is to tell you where does the data come from, right? In this diagram will be all the folders on the left. Where do we store the data, right? We mentioned about data lake, we have education cloud, we have marketing cloud, and various databases. Each of them can be a warehouse, the data cloud, obviously, with its purpose and strength. Where do the data go, which we're going to cover a little bit more later on, but these are all the arrows that you see in here, right? I cannot stress how many times I tell my kids that what I do is just linking clouds and cylinders at work using arrows. They don't believe me, but here it is. And then the last two items are actually documents that complement this diagram. Within each storage, right? Let's say the database or data cloud or data lake, you need a way to organize the data. Very similar to how you think of a closet, right? You can organize them by clothing type, or you can organize them by occasion. It really depends on how you want your data to be used in the most efficient way. The second document would be a data rules. So there is a whole process called data governance that basically manages everything about data, the definition of data, the roles and responsibilities of data, who owns them, who manage them, various compliances and security topics also. And then moving on specifically on the arrow themselves, right? They move data between systems, but also, as you can tell, we are talking about different systems of different data with different volume and schedules and needs, right? So we definitely need something called an integration plan. What it does, it basically specifies the approach, right? How you want data to be combined, split, or shared between systems, the different formats, how do you handle it? Because a key aspect to doing all this is to really maintain the system of records, right? To make sure you understand throughout the pipeline, all the arrows that you see from left to right, up and down, you know who the ownership and authority of the source data itself also. Okay, so moving forward, right, moving from architecture to the next topic, data access, discovery, and data virtualization, right? Next slide, please. We, our panelists mentioned about allowing users to access the data. Now that we have data in one place, right, we heard about using Tableau for visualization or self-serving capabilities like querying data. And in the diagram earlier, we link data sources between using data flow from the source system too. Now, what we haven't covered yet is what about the data that we didn't bring in, or data that we cannot bring in either because of physical limitations or regulations, right? Now, I want to focus on an approach that's gaining more popularity called data virtualization. Think of it as something like you don't need to know anything technical about the systems or the data format that you have to work with, right? You just use the data systems as if they're all the same. Think of this scenario. Let's say you want to build a system performance profile, right? You need data from, on the left, from SIS, you need some from LMS and CRM. At the same time, for this one time, you need some data from government web services or very specific warehouses that you haven't worked with before. So rather than spending a lot of time figuring out how to technically link those systems together, bring data in, cleansing and all that, in the middle, you'll see a data virtual layer. What that allows you to do is actually normalize all the sources, formats, so that you don't have to worry about all the technical stuff and just focus on getting values out of the various systems behind it. Now, at this point, you might think, wow, this is amazing. right? Why do we have to bring data in all the bring the data in the first place, right? In the first 15, 20 minutes that we talk about. Yes and no. Yes, you get real-time access. Yes, you can get all the data from multiple sources right away, but there's still a price to pay for this capability, right? It is resource intensive. Remember, you have to normalize all the data, and there's a lot of data transfer, and performance and data inconsistencies are also key factors. But once you manage all those, this is an amazing option to enable further data access and discovery capabilities from data multiple sources. Okay, next slide, please. So to wrap up, the last step to all this, right, having a goal, we have a plan, we implement it, it's key that we keep revising this process as a continuous improvement exercise, right? We have to keep revisiting the effectiveness, the matrix, the data architecture, all the KPI to make sure they all work perfectly together. Okay, so now that we have talked about data strategy, let's look at two more goals that will rise as time progresses. Okay, so the first one is between batch and real-time data ingestions, right? Again, integration is moving data from one system to another. There are times where we move data as a batch, essentially moving data at a scheduled time. Examples would be enrollment data, gray data that we need for dashboards on the day, on the next morning, or financial data or budget data that we probably just need to consolidate weekly, right? There's no need for real-time update for them. But then there's also other situations where the decision is very sensitive to the timeliness of the data itself, right? Maybe we need data immediate to make a decision. Examples would be students' absence or maybe assignments, missing assignments, situations like that, where the time itself would be a factor in impacting the decision. So this is where we need real-time or near real-time decisions based on the data coming in. And that's one of the capabilities that Data Cloud will be able to achieve by look at data coming in and make a decision really quickly. The second one is once we have the data in, we need to start looking for opportunities to enable self-serving. We hear our panelists mention about Tableau and self-serving, but querying their own data already. And then the big factor in doing all this is really allow department staff to do all this without depending on IT staff, so that each team will be able to utilize the time in the best way. And to do all those, we already mentioned it, we have to need a consolidated data source, whether it's a warehouse, data cloud, and then we have to enable data access, right? Including the option of data virtualization, trusted data quality, training, and support. So having said all that, in order to achieve all this, you definitely need a partner who have deep technical and business experience in addressing your business need. So we cannot wait to have a conversation to see how we can help. And I pass it back to Taylor.
Thank you. I think we have quite a few questions that came in, so let me pull those up. Let's see here. Again, if you do have any additional questions, continue putting those in the Q&A box. If we don't get to all of them today, we will follow up with you immediately after the webinar. So the first one I have here is for Brian Davis. Do you have any tips for getting executive buy-in when planning your data strategy?
Yeah, thanks, Taylor. So one of the things that I would recommend is, you know, whenever we talk about, you know, these different initiatives, whether it's AI or data or new CRM or what have you, I think one of the most important things is making sure that you are in, you have an understanding of the needs of the business, right? Because whenever you're doing any type of initiative, and especially if there's like a tech component in there at all, it needs to be business driven, right? So definitely making sure that you're understanding the different needs and challenges of the leaders in every and all the departments definitely helps. And then getting those common things together and then bringing forth a solution that's going to address all those things definitely helps. So these types of initiatives, even though they're very technical in nature, they should not be driven based on the desire to use the tech, right? One of the things that I hear a lot of times now especially with things like AI, I heard someone mention, they said AI is a solution looking for a problem. That's definitely something that you don't want to fall into. You don't want to just do something because you think it's cool or interesting, but it definitely has to serve a purpose. So if you're understanding what the business needs, those business needs are, being able to not only understand that, but articulate some of the pain that your business stakeholders are dealing with is one way to get that executive buy-in. Of course, I know you're spending big money on different solutions like this, and a lot of times executives are looking for ROI and how can we get our money back and what value are we getting there? Helping them understand too that sometimes, right, there's more than just the monetary value in some of these initiatives. Sometimes it's, you know, easing the pain, making things easier for your business stakeholders, right? There are certain situations that I've experienced, especially with LSU, some of the things that we've implemented in the past, where there are folks that now they feel like they have a brand new lease on life. Their jobs and what they do is more exciting. They're more engaged and they're more productive in what it is that they're doing. And sometimes it's hard to put a dollar on that, but sometimes quantifying that pain, and again, just making sure that you're in lockstep with your business and understanding their needs, that definitely helps, you know, bringing that to your executive stakeholders.
Awesome. Thanks, Brian. We'll stick with you for this next one too. So they're asking, I'm already using multiple tools to meet our needs. Why Data Cloud too?
Yeah. So it's important to know that, you know, you don't have to have Data Cloud, right? Data Cloud is not a requirement. Again, it goes back to what it is that you're looking to do. So for us, we already had an idea in mind. We wanted to make sure that we made it easy to sync up our data, not just sync up the data from a data standpoint, but also just making it easy to gather information about our learners or our courses or what have you. And we already wanted an easy way that the business can be more self-serving, and so they can handle it on their own. And Data Cloud happened to fit that bill for us. We were a heavy Salesforce user. It made a lot of sense, you know, for us. And so it checked off a lot of the boxes that we had independent of whatever tool that was out there. And I think that's very important, important thing to note here.
Awesome, thank you. Samuel, this next one I have for you. We're really excited right now for data analytics and BI. How would you speak to the need of data quality and governance to go alongside or before implementing data analytics tools?
Thank you, Taylor. Yeah, that's a great question. Definitely before implementation. If your decisions are based on the data that you have, then data quality is something that you need to manage, because once the data are in, when everything's implemented, it's all ingested, it's much, much harder to address the data, not just the new data coming in, but having to adjust everything, all the data that you had and all the reports. Imagine all the reports that are based on wrong data, right? You have to regenerate it, you have to redo all the models, everything sort of off because of a data quality. So you must trust your data, right? And where data governance comes in is to actually define all the rules for the data that comes in. These rules basically comes down to making sure everyone understands what the data actually means, right? Across different systems, right? You have 10 subsystems, the data has to mean the same thing across 10 systems. How does data link to each of them? who have access to the system. And to me, one of the key aspects about data governance is roles and responsibilities, right? We have something called a data steward, right? Who is the go-to or the responsible for the data. And then we could have a whole council to decide if there's a data changes. So every piece of data going through the pipeline, right? From the time they come in, there's a role, there's a reason why it should go in, it should not. And once we have all these data governance rules and framework in place, then the consumer of the data can have a peace of mind knowing that the decision is based on data that's trustworthy and confident. So definitely something you do before implementation.
Awesome, thank you. Tom, I think this one would be a great one for you. My team is not great about entering info into Salesforce. Any tips for encouraging teams to actually input their data into the system?
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the key principles to getting folks to do that is to actually make it a valuable exercise for them, right? If you're asking folks to put data into Salesforce because you need it to drive some process, you know, they might see that as overhead, where, you know, we try and configure the tools, the reports, the functions and features in Salesforce so that there's value in it, right? So log that call because it's automatically going to set up the next call for you. So when you come in the next day, you don't even have to think about it, right? You know, put in, you know, this data on this information that you gathered on this learner, because it's going to help you when you're on the call with that learner. We're going to combine that with all of the other data from the different systems, and you're going to have everything that you need at your fingertips without having to go search for it. You know, just figure out a way to make them see the value in taking that one extra or two extra steps to do something, right? You know, I think we all, you know, human nature, you know, kind of what's in it for me, you know, and so make their life easy, right? That's really what tools should do. Tools should be enablers. They should make folks' lives easy or easier, right? And so it's on us to try and design and build systems that actually do just that, enable folks and make their lives easier.
And Brian and Tom, this one I think could go to both of you. What are some examples of how LSU is going to use your data strategy and data cloud to make data-backed decisions?
Yeah. So we, one of the things that we are blessed with OCE, we have a world-class marketing group, and they do a lot of great things for us, you know, attracting new potential learners in, and we're always interested in knowing how our marketing is making a difference. And because we're leveraging Data Cloud, there are elements outside of Salesforce that we're able to pull in that can help us understand, you know, how we're doing, what the, you know, what's actually getting, you know, folks in, what's making people stay on our website, and things of that nature. Just things that we really didn't have the opportunity to know before, or it wasn't as easy to do. So there are quite a few things on the marketing side that we're looking to do. Plus there's many things for other departments that we're looking to do as well. It's everyone is excited about being able to have access to all of the student data and then being able to make decisions there. But there are quite a few examples that we can go through.
Awesome. This next one, we talked a little bit about AI earlier. They're asking, or saying rather, I want AI, but I'm not sure where to start. Do you guys have any tips for that?
Yeah, so I'll take this and Tom will weigh in. Tom knows this is my one of my favorite topics. So one of the things that's, you know, particularly interesting with the coming of ChatGPT and generative AI, I love the possibility. I talk to people about this all the time, about having conversations with their data. And that's one of the things that we're really excited about. So we have, as Tom mentioned, power users, right? So they're not technical, but they know enough of the tech to be dangerous. And so they may not be able to write code, but they know how to articulate what it is that they're looking for. And so with data cloud specifically, like Tom mentioned, they can use natural language querying, which is basically think of a ChatGPT experience, you know, with their data. So they may not know the different Salesforce objects that are behind the data that they're looking for, but they know that they want to know, you know, what's the most sought after program, or how many, or what's the most used program that we have, you know, which campus is doing, you know, better in XYZ category. And they can articulate that just with words. And now they can do that with Data Cloud and actually get information back. And a lot of it too is they're looking to vet their ideas, or they're looking to flesh out their ideas. And a lot of times with IT, right, it's very expensive, which is time and resources to get things done. And when you're coming to your IT team, a lot of times your IT team wants you to have a solid plan and they're ready to execute. But a lot of times the business, they're still trying to formulate, you know, their ideas in their mind. And so they're kind of riffing a little bit with themselves with different ideas. And so this is a way for them to vet some of their ideas that they have, test out some of the theories that they have as well, without using IT to get that done. So, and they can do that in an easy way. So we're excited to stand that up for them, and then, you know, just see how that really operates when we get to production.
So that's really exciting. AI is so cool, and the amazing things you can do with it. So. That does actually wrap us up for today. That's all the questions that we had. So thank you, Tom and Brian and Samuel and Brian Forrest. He had to jump off a little bit earlier for joining us today. And thank you, of course, to everyone else who was able to join us. It's because of your support that we are able to continue bringing you these thought leadership webinars. I will be sending out a recording of today's webinar, so keep an eye out on your inbox for that. And if you do have any additional questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. Thank you all again. I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks for having us.